welcome, everyone, and thank you for joining us here at theroadswetravel.ca. My name is David. I'll be one of your hosts today. Earlier this morning, we had a special guest drop by, Jody McBeth, and we had so much fun that he stopped by this afternoon again to do another little podcast. Jody's the pastor of the St. Croix Christian Center in St. Stephen. Welcome, Jody.
Good to be here.
Now, the topic for discussion today is hearing God's voice.
Yes, sir.
What an interesting topic. And I know lots of times I've listened to people that have been believers for 25 years and have actually told me they get very disappointed that they don't hear God's voice. They're expecting to hear this audible voice from God, and they just don't realize God communicates in all sorts of ways.
So sure does.
How about I just give it to you, and I'm looking forward to this little teaching.
I'm looking forward to it as well. And I actually done this teaching the latter part of 2016 because of the hustle and the bustle of the Christmas season. We heard all kinds of voices, buy this, do this, yes. Run here. So the Lord spoke to me and said, whose voices are my people hearing in my season? And so even when I say the Lord spoke to me, I'll explain that in reference in these points, because I don't consider myself one of these guys that's extreme super spiritual. I'm a guy that's boots on the ground, shoveling the dirt, hanging out with people. Jesus was known as a friend of publicans and sinners. He wasn't known as a big spiritual guru. Yeah. It even took a while for his own disciples to realize, oh, my Lord and my God.
Yes.
For a while, he was just local rabbi. One of the scriptures that was my hinge was out of 2 Timothy 3:16-17. And that passage says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work.
Okay.
Wow. Now, in the Greek, all scripture is given by inspiration. In the Greek, if you study that at all, that word means God breathed. Mm. He spoke that through his spirit, through men of old, to write these things down, that the whole counsel of God would come together, that every scripture, every letter, every dot, every bit that was written down was from him. He breathed it, not a man. Mm-hmm. And so when we know that God breathed that through man, just as much as he breathed into Adam and Adam became a living soul, he breathed through men and his word became the living word. It is life. Yeah. And so when we know that the man of God may be complete, how can you and I be complete? By the word of God. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And so I was thinking, Lord, how do you want us to hear? Like, what are they hearing? This passage came to me very clearly. I'm not going to speak through an audible voice when the majority of my people are not reading what I've already breathed already.
Mm-hmm.
What I've spoken, I have spoken. What has been written has been written. And he reminded me of that when he was facing those times in the desert, in the wilderness, when he was on that fast in the early part of his, way before his ministry even really launched, and Satan come along and said, well, if you cast this stone, turn it into bread, if you jump off of here, I'll give this all to you. His response was, it has been written.
Yes.
He even gleaned from his own word. And so the Lord was speaking to me like, my people are not a people of my word. There are people of my buildings. There are people of my worship. There are people of everything else. But people are always asking, they don't know my voice because they don't know my word. So do a teaching on hearing that. So the very first thing that caught my attention was, okay, so Lord, you're telling me, speaking to me, that you speak majority, mostly through your word. You got 39 books in the Old Testament. We got 27 in the New, 66 books put together for one common cause, to get people to heaven, mm-hmm. to build that relationship. And all you want to do is talk with us. And we're fighting and struggling about how do we hear God's voice? What are the mechanisms? What are the avenues? How does this all happen? And I believe that when God speaks, the majority time he speaks will be through his word. Proverbs chapter 30:5 says, every word of God is flawless.
Wow.
He is a shield to those who take refuge in him. Many people I've talked to, the regrets is because they didn't take up the shield of faith. They didn't take up that word which would protect them. The word is what gives us the wisdom, the discernment, the understanding. And if I don't have that flawless word in my heart, then I'm bound to run into problems because I realize I am flawless or I am messed up. I have many flaws. I have many things wrong with me. But if I get the flawless word inside of me, all the flaws that I have in my flesh are protected by the shield that's around me. And I take refuge in him. Sometimes I don't even know it. Mm-hmm. That his word comes out of me. Why did his word come out? Because I put the word in there. I was listening.
Yes.
And so, number one, if I could point anybody today towards any help and you're struggling to hear God's voice, know his word is his voice.
Yeah. So many times that we're going through a struggle, he guides us to his book, the Bible.
Yes.
We open that, and there's the words to bring peace.
Yes.
There's the verse to bring peace.
Absolutely.
That is God communicating with us through his scripture, through the Bible.
Well, that's the neat part. It's like John chapter 1 says, in the beginning was the word. That word in the Greek is logos. That is a written, established word.
Yes.
In the beginning was the word. The word was with God, and the word was God. And that very same chapter, down to verse 14, says, and the word became flesh and dwelt amongst us. Mm-hmm. That's the importance that God Almighty put on the word, that he decided to take everything he had ever spoken and put it in the form of Christ. Yes. Pretty powerful stuff.
Stop waiting for a voice and start looking for a verse.
I like that. That's a good one. Yeah. That's a good one. And if somebody's sitting here, I may add into this part too, don't get all condemned. Don't feel all bad on yourself. Even back in the time of Christ, he was constantly reminding his followers, you know what? Even the Greeks and the Jews are constantly looking for a sign from the stars, constantly looking for a sign from the heavens, constantly looking for something to verify. And he would constantly remind them, you listen to what I'm saying. You don't have to wait for a shooting star. You don't have to wait for something to happen and stuff. Well, there's nothing wrong with that. God will show signs and wonders to make you wonder. He will. Mm-hmm. But that's not his cornerstone point that he will make when he's speaking to his people. So that I like that. That's pretty good.
Yeah, God speaks to those who wait.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And we so often allow the busyness of life obscure what he has for us.
It's very powerful. Like that passage in Isaiah says, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Well, that wait, that word wait, because of course the Old Testament is written in Hebrew. Mm. That word wait is not a noun. It's actually a verb. Mm-hmm. It's an activity. It's like I go to a restaurant and some person comes over and they're waiting on me. They're serving me. They're not sitting around waiting for something to happen. They're waiting on me. Mm-hmm. They're going to the kitchen and they're preparing food and they're coming. I am the center of attention. And the same way with the Lord, sometimes we want to hear God's voice. We wait. How do we wait? We worship. We pray.
Yes.
We're active. Yeah. We're active with him in relationship. Powerful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we need to get tuned in.
Yeah.
I like that, getting tuned in.
Absolutely.
To hear God through the many ways he communicates with us.
Yeah.
And scripture is only one way.
Absolutely. So we have scripture, powerful stuff. Number two, he told us in the Old Testament, I'm going to bring some passages up, he was so passionate about building relationship. Back in the early part of Genesis, he made a habit of walking in the cool of the day with Adam and Eve. It wasn't about church buildings and cathedrals and all That's these right. man-made things. He came in the cool of the day. Even when Adam and Eve messed up, he still came hunting for them. Mm-hmm. Even when there was a total separation, and he knew there was total separation, he still came and said, Adam, where are you? Hebrews 8 sort of sums this up. Not only does his word come, he was passionate that his Holy Spirit would speak to us. Referenced mm-hmm. in the New Testament that it would be our teacher. Hebrews 8 and 10 says, for this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws into their minds, and I will write them on their hearts, and I will be their God. They shall be my people, and they shall not teach everyone his fellow citizen and everyone his brother, saying, know the Lord, for I will know me. For all will know me, from the least to the greatest of them. He promised that not only would we have the Holy Writ on paper, but it would get in our hearts.
Yes.
David said, Lord, I hid your word in my heart that I wouldn't sin against you. Mm-hmm. We won't always have the Bible or a phone or an iPad in front of us, but if we've got the word of God in front of us and someone needs something, it's alive.
Yeah.
And it will come out. Mm-hmm. And so God will speak through us through his word. So we're in a situation at the local Tim Hortons, or we're in a situation at work, and someone brings a challenging situation or an opportunity, I'm hearing God's voice. Him and I are chatting the whole time. I'm chatting to that other person.
Yes.
And we're having this little dialogue, and we're having this little conference call going on inside. Why? Because he was bent on having his word in my heart so we could talk back and forth, So when I open my mouth up to speak something, it's God-breathed vocabulary coming out of me mm-hmm. into someone's heart and mind.
You're his messenger.
That's it. I sum it up with the local congregation. I say, my ultimate goal is that I'm a really good water jug for Jesus.
I love it. I love it. I like what you said about Christianity is really about relationship.
Yeah.
It's not about living the law.
That's right.
It's about having a relationship with Jesus.
Absolutely.
With the Lord. And that is so important. You know, sometimes people get confused on that a little bit.
They really do, because we live in a world of rules and regulations. We live in a world and a country of law, and we need law. For guidance. We need those boundaries. But as in a court of law, it's not always the written law that the judge goes by. It's the spirit of the situation.
Yes.
The spirit of the law and the spirit of the person that's being encountered by the law. Mm. It's like Ezekiel chapter 2, verse 2 says, as he spoke to me, the spirit entered me and set me on my feet, and I heard him speaking to me. That was Old Testament stuff.
Yeah.
That was before the fire fallout. That was before mm-hmm. the baptism mm-hmm. of the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 2. And this prophet was like, and I heard him speaking to me. How was he hearing? The Spirit of the living God was speaking to this prophet. And just as he spoke back then, as he spoke in Acts chapter 2 and so on and such forth, the Holy Spirit is bent on speaking to his people. He loves it. Mm-hmm. He loves a good conversation.
I like that. The Holy Spirit guides us.
Absolutely.
And Jesus was the one that guided the people. But when Jesus left this earth, the Holy Spirit replaced him to communicate with us. Is that safe to say?
That's very safe. Okay. He said, my sheep know my voice.
Yes.
And what would be a good hinge post on what you just said, David, because everything we could say all we want to say and say, yeah, that makes sense. But what does the word say, right? So what we just agreed on mm-hmm. is agreed in Scripture, Matthew chapter 10. Mm-hmm. Verse 19, it says, but when they hand you over, do not worry about how or what you're to say, for it will be given you in the hour that you're to say it. He doesn't give you 2 days heads up. He doesn't give you a fax 3 days in advance. Most times I've seen that so many times. I'm out in the middle of battle. I'm in the middle of a situation. And I sometimes there's no advance. It's not even an hour heads up. It's milliseconds. I open my mouth and there it is. Why? Because the Spirit of the Lord is in me. And then he goes on to say, for it is not you who speaks, but it is the Spirit of your Father who speaks in you. Mm-hmm. Talk about being a vessel.
Yeah.
When I hush and say, Lord, you take over this vessel. It is your temple. You abide. You reside in this tabernacle. So mm-hmm. take it over. And when I open up this mouth of mine, let it become something that's holy for God. Mm-hmm. And it comes out and it's like, yeah, there's not a lot of heads up. It's just we're instant in season and out of season. Mm-hmm. The Holy Spirit button never has an off switch.
He's always with us 24/7.
Exactly. So the key is for the believer is know that my sheep know my voice, Jesus said. We know the voices of many things, but as a disciple of Christ, the work of the cross, the work of Christ gets so easy when we know his voice. Even Jesus said, I don't do unless the Father says, I don't say unless the Father tells me to do it. When we get to that concept and I'm working with the flow of the Holy Spirit instead of trying to figure it out, and I hear his voice through the Spirit of the living God, I'm like, okay, this is so much easier. I can do so much more work in such a short period of time because it's no longer me. I'm just the vessel showing up.
And we need that attitude to get tuned in. Now we really can hear him through the Spirit.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and he'll guide and direct us.
That's the bottom line. I reminded people, and I'll get to the next point in a second, but I think it's only fair to say this. We've noticed, I've traveled in the United States, we've traveled here in Canada, we've noticed a few things that has caught my attention. I have noticed that churches like having fine buildings, fine music, fine gatherings, but one thing that is missing amongst our gatherings is the moving of the power of the Holy Spirit. It was sought for, it was searched for, it was asked for. It was really almost like we need this to make work what needs to work.
Mm-hmm.
And what I'm finding and I found, and it's been a conviction of mine, is this, are my gatherings, are the gatherings of God, people, God's people gathered together, are they Holy Spirit led? Are people even being baptized anymore in my Holy Spirit? That's how I'm going to speak. And so a conviction of mine is simply this, is that, Lord, in our gatherings at St. Croix, I don't want to do one day without you. I don't want to do one song without you. I want everything being totally orchestrated by you. Flood this place, every square inch of the atmosphere. I want it to be all God. We are human. It will get interrupted many times by human influence. But at the end of the day, I believe the church in North America right now needs a whole revival on the power of the moving of the Spirit and an outpouring like we never saw before.
Wow.
I believe that.
Yeah. I mean, when you put God first in your life, in your church, in your place of worship, when God is always number one, you basically say, I'm yours, guide me, Lord.
Yes, sir.
When he's first,
yeah,
some amazing things are going to happen for the kingdom.
Absolutely. Yeah. Powerful. Yeah. I've been in points of ministry where, led by the Spirit, I'm driving down the road, and I know we've all been there, doesn't regardless of the office we're in, and God will say, go in that home. Yeah. Well, that's his voice. That's his Spirit, right?
Those little whispers.
Yeah.
That's the Spirit.
Yeah.
It's like when we do something wrong.
Yeah.
You shouldn't really be doing that, David.
Absolutely.
I mean, where does that come from?
Absolutely.
That's the Spirit. Yeah.
You know, that's the devil not putting that there.
Yeah. The enemy is saying, do it now. Well,
that's funny, eh? That's funny. Absolutely. Absolutely.
And he speaks through visions and dreams also.
Yeah. He said, my old people are going to see visions, and the old ones are going to dream dreams, and young ones are going to see visions. And
yeah,
we're seeing that. We're seeing youngsters have dreams and see visions. And a lot of that comes through. And again, the church has done a lot away with a lot of this stuff again, because in the book of Corinthians, it calls them the gifts of the Spirit.
Yes.
And the latter part of that passage in Corinthians, it says he will do it as he sees fit or as he wills. But a lot of the church environment, mostly in North America, we've gotten away from this part of the visions, the dreams, the prophetic, mm-hmm, the nine gifts of the Spirit, if you will, because of the misuse of the gifts. It's turned into a fleshly thing, hear me, see me. And we will flock to, if we hear, oh, prophet so-and-so is coming to town, we will flock to hear that prophet. Well, back in the Old Testament, if prophet Jeremiah was showing up, people ran for their lives. Because mm-hmm, it was the word of God showing up, and usually it was a rebuke. Mm-hmm. It wasn't tickle your ears and make you all feel good.
Right.
So yes, I realize that the prophetic in the New Testament is different than the prophetic in the Old Testament. The prophetic in the New Testament more is to an exhortation, declaring the good things of God, declaring his word, his will, and his way. If people would just allow God to speak the way he wants to speak, he will use any avenue he chooses to. If people dream a lot, he will use dreams. If people, yes, vision a lot, he'll use visions. If people write a lot, he'll use their writings.
It's not always the same with every person.
No, no, not a bit. Different,
yeah. So the Holy Spirit is amazing.
Yeah.
We can just clear our mind and hear him and listen to him and be obedient.
That's the key. I've seen, like through the prophetic, the word of knowledge. Someone comes up, maybe David, you've been there. You told me an example about the time you was at the shopping mall a few days ago and and you were sort of hesitant about speaking to this man.
Yeah.
But the Holy Spirit spoke. Well, the wife encouraged you, but then the Holy Spirit spoke and nudged you on. And you reached in the pocket and pulled that card out, and tears came to his eyes. And that card and your activity was used as a word of knowledge or word of wisdom. Someone comes to us looking for understanding, looking for direction. The book of James tells you and I very clearly, if we need wisdom and ask for it, he will give it to us liberally. Mm-hmm. All wisdom is given. So word of wisdom or personal prophecy, someone comes along and they are looking for direction and some wisdom, but also a prophetic word. I done two baby dedications on Sunday morning.
Yes.
And I was excited about that. And I was getting ready for it Saturday night. Typically that style of service is very formal. It's very A, B, C, D, E, F, G. And I was just working along. Saturday night, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, this is a generation that will seek after me. And so one little girl that we were dedicating, the Lord spoke over to me, and she said, and the Lord said, that young lady, that young baby is going to be like a Mary. She's going to be willing to sit at my feet. She's going to be willing to pray and worship. She's going to seek after me. And you need to share that with the congregation Sunday morning.
Mm-hmm.
And there was another little baby that we had to dedicate. His name was Elijah.
Wow.
Yeah,
wow.
So you know the rest of the story. And the Holy Spirit again spoke to me and said, you need to share this over this. This young man is called into the prophetic, and his dad is as well, so he needs to know that as well. So the Holy Spirit was just giving this all to me, and I was writing it down faster than I could keep up.
Wow. Wow.
And so Sunday morning, we had ourselves a time, mm-hmm, because the Holy Spirit spoke to me on Saturday night, and I told the people, this will be a prophetic word. And many times when I get up and preach, I will say sometimes, very rarely, but it comes out, this is a prophetic message that the congregation needs to hear today.
Yes.
Sometimes it's instructive, but how do I know that? Because I am very careful to listen to the voice of God.
Yes.
And we'll say, you know what? Do not, he said in Thessalonians chapter 5 and 19, do not quench the Spirit. Do not despise prophetic utterances, but examine everything carefully. Hold fast to that which is good. And so many times people will come and say, I got a prophetic word. I see this on Facebook, prophetic word of the day. It's like the Christian's horoscope. Well, I'm sorry, I'm not buying all that stuff out there. I'm holding on. I'm not going to quench it and say, well, nothing's of God if it's prophetic, but I won't shut it down, but I will test it. How? I examine it very carefully. Does it match the word of God? Yes. Is there a witness in my spirit? Mm-hmm. Does it edify the body? Does it glorify God? Does it terrify Satan?
Yeah,
if I do all that, okay, it's the prophetic. Nothing wrong with it. God still speaks through the voice of the prophetic through all nine gifts of the Spirit. He is still speaking. I believe he's speaking louder than he's ever spoke.
Mm-hmm.
I believe he's trying like crazy to get our attention as believers. I really do.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Wow. Amen. Yeah. I like that.
Yes, sir.
And he speaks through godly counsel.
Yes, he does.
Through the elders and people of the church. And
yeah. Godly counsel, I believe, is something that we need to glean more from. We have the Abrahams and even the Isaacs now in this world that we're living in that has so much godly counsel. Even Proverbs 11 and 14 says, where no counsel is, the people fall.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's another passage that says, without no vision, the people perish.
Mm-hmm.
So we need vision, but we also need counsel to go with the vision.
Mm-hmm.
And so where no counsel is, the people fall. But in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. Now, there's a big difference between multitude of counselors when you go blabbing everything on Facebook and everyone starts firing. That's not counsel.
No.
That's people just throwing garbage out there. But there are wise men and wise women of the faith that are growing, that are learning, that have been through a few storms, and they have been through a few shipwrecks, but they've also won a few victories too. When you and I see those people, and we have the confidence of those people, God will use those people and speak through them, the counsel. It will save our young Christians and our young people so many problems and so much hassle because God chooses to speak through the seasoned saints of his people, of his word, and say, okay, there's counsel here.
Mm-hmm.
And he will use that. So yeah, absolutely. Godly counsel is huge in this day and age.
Well, every time we go to church on Sunday, I mean, there's counsel, godly counsel.
Yes, sir.
Giving us a message that he or she's been directed by the Holy Spirit.
That's the bottom line.
Yeah.
No, so we get that and we hold on to that dearly and we need it. We mm-hmm. just need it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's harder in this day and age because we live in a day and age where you don't need to tell me what to do. You don't have to tell me. I'll figure it out on my own. There is that generation mentality that is out there, but that's not of God. The word says no man is an island unto himself.
Mm-hmm.
And so if we're out there today and you're listening to this podcast and you think, well, I'll figure this out on myself. No, that doesn't come from God.
No.
That Satan wants you to be thinking you're an island, that you don't, no one cares about you. You can figure it out on your own. That's not godly thinking.
Mm-hmm.
And we get that out of our mind. We realize we need the body that are fit knitly together, the Bible says.
Yeah.
Working together.
And we need that fellowshipping.
Oh, my,
either through prayer groups.
Yes.
You know, every time we attend one of those or attend a function, that's other believers are there sharing and wanting more, hungry for Jesus.
Absolutely.
We learn incredibly.
Amazingly. And sometimes we don't even realize until after the event's been over. It's like, oh, my land, they just said something to me. They had no idea what they were talking about.
Yeah. God puts people in our path for a reason, and God puts us in the path of other people for a reason.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And we see that all too often, don't we, which is powerful. Mm-hmm. Need to see it more.
Yes.
And I believe we will. Next one we have, and if there's anything there along the lines of this, David, jump right in. And I have another one here, confirmation. Matthew 18 and 16, by the mouth of two or three witnesses, every fact may be confirmed. Many times folks will come along and tell you a yarn about this situation, that situation. Your response is, oh, is that so? When I was studying to be a pastor, and one thing that a senior man of God in my life, Reverend E.S. McKean, always reminded us, if you want a doctrine to be a doctrine, it has to be established two or three times in the Word of God.
Yes.
We can't pull out one scripture and say, well, that's a doctrine of the faith.
Mm-hmm.
And so if somebody brings you and I an idea or a suggestion, and we're not quite sure about it, if you can't find that idea or suggestion to be confirmed two or three times in the passage of Scripture, it no doubt may be good for them for that day,
yes,
but it's not needed for the whole foundation of their faith. Mm-hmm. See that all the time. It's like one of the prophets was Elijah get caught up by fire. So you could pull that passage out and say, oh, Elijah got caught up by fire. Well, bless God, everybody ought to be caught up by fire. Well, no, that only happened the once.
Yes.
And so, and not that God couldn't, but that's not the standard.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what I mean by confirmation. Let's confirm. Let's be wise people. Wise as serpents, gentle as doves. And know the word. It all goes back to point number one. When we know the word, we know we are safe because we got the shield. So when the Spirit speaks and when people speak, we all come together on the same page.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
And that's sometimes we often believe that God speaks to us to do something. We should use counsel to clarify that. That's actually God speaking.
Absolutely. And we see that often. Like even in the book of Acts, it says after Paul and Peter and all these guys were out teaching, those people, I believe, was in Thessalonica, where they would search the scriptures diligently to make sure these things were so.
Mm-hmm.
And that's important for us to do that, is to verify that through godly counsel and make sure that, hey, let's confirm this. Make sure it is confirmed with God's Spirit, God's Word, God's people.
And the peace of God.
Peace of God, powerful one. Amen.
Yeah.
Peace, peace, wonderful peace coming down from the Father above, right?
One of my sons is a youth pastor, and we had a discussion one day, and I keep praying and asking God, help me make this decision.
Yes, sir.
And he just said to me, well, do you have peace with it? And when he told me that, you know what? Yeah, when you have peace with a decision.
That's it. Mm-hmm. Colossians 3:15, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, mm-hmm. to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful.
I like it.
I asked the question, what is ruling? What is ruling the heart? Maybe you're listening to the podcast right now. What's ruling? I find in the body of Christ, the peace of God is not always ruling. I see folks that are full of anxiety, that are full of stress, they're full of worry, they're full of pain, they're full of anxiousness, they're full of all kinds of things. But one thing that is not ruling as it could be ruling as he wants it is his peace. If his peace was always ruling, we would indeed be knowing, okay, this is the part of the body I should be involved in now, or this or that. I believe when Paul gave this out, people were anxious. In this letter he was writing to this church, it was a very anxious church. They were very upset. There's a lot of stuff going on. Do we need to do this? Do we need to do that? Do we need to listen to this prophet or that prophet, this preacher? That? There's all kinds of things going on in this town, in this church. And he just said, let the peace of Christ rule in your heart. And if we want to hear the voice of God, it is true. Like, do you have peace? Is there a settlement? Because that's the way God works. That's the way he operates. That's the way he does business, by peace, peace, wonderful peace.
Yeah, God is not the author of confusion.
No.
Satan wants us in confusion all the time.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah, God wants us in peace.
Yes, sir.
God encourages, Satan criticizes.
That's it. Absolutely. And I believe that the reason the world and the church world, we find ourselves in so much chaos half of the time, is because we forget Satan doesn't care if we go to church 110 times a year.
Mm-hmm.
But he does care if we have peace. He came to seek, kill, and destroy. And he's seeking for the peace, and he'll kill your peace, and he'll destroy it if he can. But it goes back to the word. I've got the word. The word's my shield. The word's my helper. And he's going to speak. And when God speaks, Satan flees. He doesn't stand a chance.
Yeah, that's good. That's a good word.
It's powerful.
That's good food.
We'll chew on that. We'll chew on that.
And circumstances.
Absolutely.
The circumstances we're in.
How many times? I'm not going to go through the whole passage, but if you take your Bibles out and read Acts 18 and see how all these folks came together in Corinth, and how he found a certain Jew named Aquila, a native of Pontus, and how Paul just connected with all these different people. They connected and built relationship. And as a result of this relationship, things were built, things were done, partnerships were fortified together. And we see that all the time, that just circumstances, the world calls it karma or luck or chance or all kinds of things. But really, God's a God of timing.
Yes.
When he says in Jeremiah, I know the thoughts that I have for you, says the Lord. Well, those aren't just random thoughts. They're just hoping for the best. He's not a genie in a lead lamp.
Mm-hmm.
Scratch that thing three times and out he pops. That's not Jesus.
Yeah, we expect him to jump when we speak.
Yeah.
That's not having a relationship with Jesus.
Yeah, we've already got Santa Claus.
That's right.
And we've already got the Easter Bunny, and those things are found to be not true. Yeah. But one thing that is true, one thing that is pure, one thing that is right, is when God lines people up and God lines circumstances up. I could tell you story after story when we traveled about circumstances that we would get in front of people. I remember one time an alternator went on the motor coach that we were driving, and I didn't have 5 cents to rub them together. And we were just going from one love offering to the next, and there's more love than there was offering half the time. And the alternator in a motorhome is not very cheap. And so, long story short, the place that we were parked at, it just so happened that just two parking spots down was a mechanic. He came over.
Wow.
He took that thing apart, never charged me a dime. Wow. He said, here's my account number down at Auto Parts, whatever the name of the store was. Here's my account number. You go down and get this part. Put this on my account number. Never cost me anything. Wow. God used a circumstance where, I was broke down and I was frustrated because we had to get to our next place to preach. Bottom line was God used a man, just an average Joe, got to know him a little bit, got to put some seed into him, and just circumstance after circumstance. And the next thing you know, here we are connecting with people. God uses circumstances to speak to us and through us.
Yes.
Constantly.
We got to believe and we got to trust in him.
That's it. That's it. We have to believe as believers that God is interested in our Mondays to Saturdays as much, if not more so, than our Sunday mornings.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I believe. And I believe that with all my heart is like, let's not just give God 30 minutes or 40 minutes of our time on Sunday morning. Let's give him the whole week and just see what happens.
That's right. So it comes back to a relationship with God.
Bottom line.
Relationship. And it's going to be hard to have a relationship, a real relationship.
It is.
A loving relationship.
Yeah.
Where we can trust him, put him first in our lives,
and
believe in him.
Yeah.
That everything's possible through him.
I believe he wants to speak to us sometimes more than we're willing to hear from him. But I encourage anybody out there today, you're listening to this podcast, know God wants to speak, and he's not in the business of beating us over the head with a hammer. He's not in the business of finding all your faults. He's not in the business of just doing those things. He's in the business of building relationship. He is a good, good father. Chris Tomlin just came out with a song a few months ago, good, good father.
I like it.
And a good father, my father, when I talked to him, it was rare when I, as a boy, that my father spoke to me in a judging manner, if ever at all. It was an instructive manner. It was guidance. It was counsel. It was help. Until this day, I respect a lot of people, but my father, I probably respect the most because the time that he invested into me as a boy to build that relationship. Our Heavenly Father is the same. He can hardly wait, I believe, to hear from us in the morning we get up.
Yeah, how true it is, and he's always there.
That's it.
All we got to do is call out for him.
And he's there.
Reach your hand out.
Yes,
take
sir.
My hand, Lord.
Yep.
Wonderful day. Another great podcast.
Yes, sir.
So,
yes, sir.
Pastor Jody, it's been wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for listening today. And God bless and have an amazing week. Amen.